Welcome, everyone. We're so glad you could join us today for What Happens When Things Go Off the Rails, Ramp Management for When the Best Laid Plans Don't Go as Planned. My name is Jennifer Carinci, and I am the Program Director for STEM Education Research at the American Association for the Advancement of Science and Principal Investigator for our Improving Undergraduate STEM Education Award, or as we call it, the AAAS IUS Initiative. Today, we officially kick off the AAAS IUS Summer Labs, Catalyzing Inclusive, Transformative Undergraduate STEM Education. During this month, the Summer Labs will feature 8 days of events. These events are dedicated to community building, facilitating knowledge sharing, exploring issues of diversity, equity, and inclusion in STEM, building towards institutional transformation, and helping faculty succeed. This event comes on the heels of over a year of unprecedented disruption in education. You can see the entire series of events, new speaker information, and access session join links via the URL for our AAAS IUS website being placed in the chat now. Throughout today and our Summer Lab series, please tweet with us and join the conversation on Twitter at IUS Program to share hashtag IUS Insights, gleaned from the speakers and your own experience. As we emerge from the pandemic, we seek to avoid returning to the status quo in STEM education. Instead, the goal of the IUS community is to push the boundaries of traditional STEM education to discover and implement evidence-based strategies and practices that improve the way we teach and learn STEM. It's up to all of us to make undergraduate STEM education an inclusive space. You, our IUS community members, are the ones leading research in these areas. The Summer Labs feature NSF program directors, STEM education experts, and IUS principal investigators and co-principal investigators like you. Like those featured on our virtual stage at this event, we hope you will continue to engage with our initiative and share your work so we can transform undergraduate STEM education together. As I mentioned before, this past year has brought unprecedented change, and this disruption has likely impacted many of your IUS awards. Today, we will hear from several IUS PIs and also have NSF program officers in attendance who will show us how to manage our grants and seize opportunities during this time of change, whether related or unrelated to COVID-19, to set our projects up for future success. I'd now like to introduce our lineup for today's program. And as I do, you are invited to introduce yourselves in the chat if you haven't done so already. First, you will hear from Dr. Keith Sergeyev, Lead Program Director for the IUS Program. We also have with us today Dr. John Jackson, Co-Lead Program Director for the IUS Program, and Dr. Bonnie Green. We will then hear from experienced principal investigators who will share their tricks and insights for how they seized opportunities to change course for the better. And we will be hearing from Dr. Cindy Bukak, Dr. Eric Davishaw, Elliot Douglas, Britt Holbrook, Julie Lindsay, and Tracy Hammond. Feel free to drop questions for presenters, NSF, or your fellow PIs in the chat as we go. Following these presentations, we will convene in breakout rooms led by our featured PIs. You will self-select your breakout room and discuss the following question. In the management of your project, was there a time that you found you had to make an unexpected change due to any circumstance? If so, what was the circumstance? How did you address the issue? And do you think you were successful? After the breakout rooms, we will reconvene in the main session to hear some key takeaways and also have a time for open Q&A and discussion. Before we dive in, I have just a couple housekeeping notes. This presentation is being recorded. The recording will be made available on the AAAS IUS website in the archives section on the AAAS IUS Summer Labs page, the same page that has access information for this and all of the sessions. Additionally, we have closed captioning for this workshop. You can download and view the full transcript by clicking the CC button at the bottom of your screen. Lastly, if you have questions during this session, please ask them via the chat button in your Zoom window. Following this session, we hope you will join us for the Meet the IUS Community Networking session taking place at 5 p.m. Eastern. Also, don't miss tomorrow's workshop, Centering Identity, the design of an inclusive teaching course for STEM faculty. During this workshop, attendees will learn to advance the awareness, self-efficacy, and the ability of students and faculty to cultivate inclusive STEM learning environments and to develop themselves as reflective, inclusive practitioners. That workshop will begin at 11 a.m. Eastern. Oh, and did I mention, don't forget to tweet your hashtag IUseInsights. Now, without further ado, I would like to turn it over to Dr. Keith Sverdrup, IUse Program Lead.
Well, thank you very much, Jennifer. I greatly appreciate it. I want to thank certainly you, your team, AAAS, for the tremendous job that you've done in putting together this Summer Labs series, an 8-day series of events for IU's PIs, co-PIs, and prospective leaders of projects. This is an opportunity for all of us to get together, learn from one another, share ideas. And the session that we're about to hear, I think, is going to be a particularly interesting and valuable one in light of what all of you have gone through in this last pandemic year. I'm excited to hear what the presenters have in store for us. I want to thank them for their work and what we're going to be learning together today. In addition to myself, John Jackman and Bonnie Green, program officers in IUs, are also with us. And I'd like to take just a moment, if possible, if Bonnie and John, if you'd introduce yourselves. Bon, perhaps first, if you're there.
Sure. Hi, everybody. I'm Bonnie Green. I'm a rotating program officer from East Stroudsburg University, which is one of the state schools in Pennsylvania. And I'm happy to be here to answer your questions.
Thanks, Bon. John, are you available?
Sure. I am also a rotating program officer. My home institution is Iowa State University, and my field of study is industrial engineering.
Thanks, John. One last thing. I'd like to emphasize the fact that we are very grateful to all of you as principal investigators and co-principal investigators working hard diligently to push the frontiers of best practices in STEM undergraduate education. This is something that is critical for this nation, and we appreciate your work, your dedication, your expertise. So thank you very much. And I'm looking forward to the presentations that we're about to hear. Jennifer, I'll turn it back over to you.
Great, thanks so much, Keith. And thank you, Bonnie and John. I hope that you in the audience take advantage of these wealth of information here and stick some questions into the chat for the NSF program officers, for our PI speakers, and for your fellow PIs who also have resources to share and crowdsource with you. So I think we're due now for the presentation portion of our programming, and we'll be going in the order you can see on the screen, starting with Cindy Bukak from the University of Richmond. Cindy, you're up.
Just gonna share my screen here. Okay, well, thank you very much for this opportunity. And just to let you know, I'm Cindy Bukach from the University of Richmond. And before I begin, I want to acknowledge my two collaborators, Jane Couperis and Kathy Reed. I'd also like to thank NSF for their generous funding, as well as the APS Teaching Fund and the James S. McDonald Foundation, who were instrumental in kickstarting our project. So PURSUE, our project, is an acronym for Preparing Undergraduates for Research in STEM Using Electrophysiology. Our goal is to provide effective and accessible undergraduate level training materials in cognitive electrophysiology using best course design practices. Cognitive electrophysiology is a direct measure of brain activity using scalp electrodes with millisecond precision. The flexibly designed teaching materials include introductory modules that can be inserted into broader courses and a full set of full semester course modules on cognitive electrophysiology that have hands-on lab activities. We also have developed a series of multimedia tools to enhance student learning and to increase access to training for institutions without EEG equipment. We've created a large database with common experimental paradigms along with data analysis labs. Now in our second phase, our focus is on assessing and revising the full semester course and hosting a set of workshops to support faculty implementation and adaptation of the materials. So, like many of you, COVID forced us to make several changes to our original project plans. When COVID struck, we were just finishing the final year of phase one and simultaneously starting the first year of phase two. So today I'm going to briefly talk about five strategies that help us adapt our grant activities to these unexpected changes due to the pandemic. The first major change was giving up on our in-person meetings. This decision affected a number of our activities, as I list here. The greatest impact, however, was on our faculty workshops and on supervision of student research. So, rather than suspending our participating faculty workshops, we moved to a virtual format. This worked well in part because we had already established working relationships with our original group of faculty, but also assigning pre-workshop homework helped us to keep the meetings efficient and discussion-based. Virtual check-ins also allowed us to share ideas and resources to help each other deal with COVID-related challenges in our teaching and research. So this was very important as a faculty group. The second major shift I want to highlight is pivoting to remote research with our students. We developed procedures for managing remote student research and skill development. For example, we worked with students to use remote access to MATLAB or to get them student versions of MATLAB. We put data on servers, we created videos of data processing steps, we used open access statistical software such as Jamovi. In my own lab, I incorporated daily morning check-ins, weekly project meetings, peer-to-peer coffee rooms for group work and to develop lab cohesion. We had online socials and a timeline of project milestones to help keep students engaged and on track. It soon became evident that our original timeline wouldn't work. So when the pandemic hit, our administration and teaching responsibilities, including making drastic changes to our courses, delayed our material development. This in turn delayed implementation and workshop schedule. So rather than cancel these activities, we were able to re-envision our timeline. So in managing the grant timeline, I highly recommend using a timeline chart such as this one here to keep track of all the moving pieces and to get a bird's eye view of your project activities. In the end, we decided to push the majority of our workshops forward by an entire year. This meant planning for a no-cost extension at the end of the grant, which you see highlighted in our timeline in yellow. This adjustment allowed us to focus on activities that did not require in-person meetings, such as material development and revision, data analysis, and writing manuscripts. We also decided to move some of our activities forward in time. So for example, the switch to remote teaching and training left many faculty worldwide scrambling for materials. Although our materials had not gone through all of our planned revision cycle, we decided to release some of our data and our draft versions of data analysis labs to serve the broader community. Another strategy was to adapt. Another strategy was to adapt methodologies. Fortunately, the Pursue database was already complete, and it enabled students to engage in authentic research. Our students were able to develop online experiments also to test some of our multimedia tools in a remote teaching environment. I'm having trouble advancing my slides. There we go. Okay. So, delayed and canceled activities can have significant impact on the budget. Keeping an eye on your budget is critical. I maintain a practice of tracking my grant expenditures in an Excel sheet and then checking the balances monthly with the budget records from the accounting office. Also, some institutions develop COVID policies to help cover non-reimbursed expenses. For example, my institution covered non-reimbursed travel expenses. It's always wise to investigate what your institution can do to help with these unexpected events. When we adjusted the timeline, we also decided to delay hiring for some of our staff. This ensured that we would have money to cover staff when we were able to resume the delayed activities. Importantly, not all budget impacts are negative. Virtual events saved us some travel money, and those savings can help cover costs during the no-cost extension year, because of course, you don't get extra money in that final year. Sometimes it's better to ask your program officer if you can reallocate funds. So for example, when we changed the final phase one workshop to a virtual event, I contacted my program officer and received permission to reallocate those funds to meet other needs related to completing the project. When making adjustments to grant activities and spending, it's critical to consult and inform all of your grant stakeholders. The PIs met virtually to figure out what adjustments could be made, and then we also checked with our participating faculty to make sure they would be willing to participate in a virtual workshop. It was important to coordinate with our external assessment team to ensure that they'd be willing to commit to the no-cost extension year without increasing the budget. We also communicated with our NSF program officer to obtain approval for significant reallocation of funds and adjustments to the timeline. And then finally, it's good to keep your institutional grants office informed of any significant changes affecting the budget and the timeline of the grant so that they can do their job efficiently. And of course, any major changes and adjustments should be included in your annual report or final reports. Sometimes adaptations can have positive outcomes, and the pandemic provided new opportunities for us to reach and extend our goals. For example, we were invited to participate in a panel on teaching psychophysiology in the pandemic, hosted by the Society for Psychophysiological Research. This event was attended by 120 participants around the world, and thus extended the impact of our grant. Similarly, some of the goals of our grant aligned with COVID-related needs. So thus the pre-release of our lab modules, though still requiring work, was able to help over 350 instructors from 33 countries. Finally, we were able to take advantage of several opportunities to move our grant-related work forward that enhanced the quality of our products and productivities. So to end, I hope some of these strategies are helpful to you, and I just want to point to a new website that's coming out in the next day or two, and so please check it out, and thank you so much for the opportunity to share our experiences with you.
Great, thanks so much for sharing today, Cindy, very thoughtful. Planning, lots of keys about communications with various offices and NSF, as well as I love seeing the the lemonade. I'd encourage everybody to reflect about how you've made your own lemonade and feel free to share some of those tips in the chat and keep thinking about them for when we join our breakout groups. And again, feel free to ask questions of Cindy and all of the other presenters as we go. Next up, we have Eric Davishal from Whatcom Community College. Take it away, Eric. Eric, I'm having a little trouble hearing you.
Yeah, sorry, I was muted. The unmute button moved on me twice as this video was moving all around. So let me share my screen. All right, well, thank you to American Academy of Science for inviting me here, and of course, National Science Foundation for funding our work. Our project is about engaging STEM learners with hands-on models to build representational competence. Representational competence, I guess in this presentation, I'm not defining. So for those who aren't familiar with that term, that refers to a learner or subject matter expert's ability to move back and forth between different representations of a concept in the context of learning, problem solving, communicating, et cetera. I wanna acknowledge my co-PIs, Lee Singleton, who's a math professor at Whatcom Community College, and Todd Haskell, who is a psychology professor at Western Washington University. And I am an engineering professor at Whatcom Community College. So this is a multidisciplinary project. And I'll talk a little bit more about what we're doing before I talk about actually two off the rails experiences, one like many of the rest having to do with COVID. So our project is all about developing hands-on collaborative learning activities for calculus, integral calculus, and engineering statics. So already you can kind of get a preview that we've had some challenges in the last year. Our first year, we started this project in 2018, really focused on developing models, curriculum, and assessments, piloting those activities in the classroom, and abstracting elements of what we were doing to investigate deeper in lab studies that Todd ran in the psychology labs at Western. The original plan for the project was starting in late 2019, moving forward to a longitudinal study in intact classrooms using intervention and control sections, some with the models, some without the models, to assess their effectiveness and learn some more. And I've got some pictures here. The top picture is students in a calculus class working with some 3D printed models to explore the concept of volumes of revolution. And the second picture is students in a statics class working with a model to explore 3D vectors. So just thinking, kind of building on the previous presentation and thinking overall about how to approach changes, one thing that we've really done is really try to keep our eye on the ball in terms of what are our overall goals of the project and what research questions are we trying to address, and using that to frame all of our decision-making and guide our decision-making. So the goals for this project were first to develop these models and the associated activities. Second, assess their effectiveness toward improving representational competence when used in the context of traditional coursework. And third, to identify characteristics of the activities that make them effective for all learners and or subgroups of learners. So I'm not gonna go too deep into the research questions here, but just to kind of give some framework for what follows. So our first off the rails experience actually predates COVID. So we were awarded this project starting fall 2018. When we proposed the project, our enrollments, I'm looking at statics enrollments in particular here in 2017-18, we had 50 something students, and over multiple years we had determined that we could build a statistical study and have significant results. And it's basically as soon as the grant was awarded, our enrollment started to take a dive. And we immediately were worried that we would not have enough numbers to have statistically meaningful results from our classroom studies. And so That was our first off the rails experience. After a little bit of panic and discussion and thinking about alternate methods, I was able to schedule a meeting with our program officer, which brings me to my second recommendation, is to really maintain open communication with your program officer. We've had two over the course of our project so far, and they've both been excellent resources. So we discussed two options. One was to shift our project more towards qualitative methods. And the second, actually suggested by the program officer, was to broaden the data collection to additional schools. And that program officer actually suggested we write a supplemental proposal to get a little bit more funding to support that work of recruiting additional faculty at neighboring community colleges and expanding our study. And so that's what we did. The supplemental was awarded in August 2020. We submitted it in February 2020, and there was some delays in that processing because that's right in the time when COVID hit. And one of the lemonade events that came out of that is that it's also allowed us to generate another data stream into the project in terms of collecting faculty impressions of their use of the curriculum and learning how it could fit into different teaching styles. So in the meantime, while we're waiting to hear for sure about this supplemental, the COVID pandemic hit, Whatcom Community College moved to all remote online instruction in March 2020. And this was our second panic because we're trying to investigate the effectiveness of collaborative hands-on learning in the classroom. And suddenly we can't get our students hands on anything, nor can we have them working together in the classroom. Recall those pictures before that have groups of students all touching the same thing. This was all of a sudden totally impossible. So in this ongoing part of the project, we've tried to figure out how to do hands-on learning at home and online. Our primary approach has been to scale down our kits of models to something that was lower cost and then we could send home to each student. There's a picture here of the calculus model kit that we send home to students. We had to decrease the per kit cost significantly because now instead of one kit per four students, we had a kit for every student. So we had a fourfold increase in the number of models we needed to produce. As a result of the pandemic, we weren't, similar to the previous presentation, we weren't able to hold an in-person workshop that we were planning for those new faculty that we brought into the project through the supplemental award. And we got approval from the program officer to reallocate those funds towards this increased model production. So that's what we ended up doing there. And we also found some new opportunities here. So one of the things that we observed even in the pilot studies was that the models were really effective for facilitating student-to-student communication in the classroom as they were engaging in these active learning exercises. And having identified their utility as a communication tool, we've now kind of removed that collaborative element of the projects. And now we can see is there's something to just students getting their hands on things and having additional sensory modalities in terms of how they can interact with the concepts. The other thing that this transition did, the other piece of lemonade, is it gave us a new format and more student fluency with using videos to submit assignments. We had students submitting videos to document their work with the models, which provided us more data stream. We do still have some ongoing challenges. As we've scaled up our model production, both to additional colleges and now one per student, the 3D printing approach that we're using to produce our models is really not appropriate for this scale of production. We basically have a handful of 3D printers running around the clock, generating models. And as a community college, we're definitely not really set up to be a production shop. There's been challenges in the distribution logistics, and also challenges in the curriculum itself. A lot of the activities are designed to promote productive struggle, but when a student's working with some of these activities, maybe late at night, isolated at home, in an online context, sometimes it's just struggle and frustration. The last couple challenges are that because of COVID, Some of the teaching assignments for our, and how departments have adapted to COVID, some of the teaching assignments for our partner faculty got realigned, and some faculty didn't get any sections of the courses where they were going to use the models in, so that was a challenge. And we also are doing all of this work in a shifting landscape in terms of student preparation and levels of engagement. I don't know about the rest of you, but our students are now in their fourth quarter of online instruction, and they're totally exhausted and kind of done with it. So kind of the key takeaways that I wanted to communicate today is, one, I think in both of these cases for us, maintaining open communication with our program officer has been critical. Just being able to get responses to emails. We've had some Zoom meetings. I had one in-person meeting when I was back in DC. All of that was really helpful for problem solving. Keeping the focus on the overarching goals and research questions in the project, and thinking about how challenges might provide new opportunities to approach those goals is also a key takeaway. And I think I have a few more slides kind of more about the project in general, but I think I'm up on time. Is that true?
You can take another minute if you want, Eric.
Okay, sure. So just a few more slides just to share some of our activities. In case people are interested in learning more. So these are some example statics activities, learning about forces, simple structures, and vectors. And our calculus activities focused on sections and volumes of revolution and centroids, all in the general emphasis of promoting emphasis on conceptual learning and building active learning activities into the classroom. And then we have two websites. If you're interested in learning more, I can put these URLs in the chat after this. But all of our calculus activities are at this Grasp the Math website, and the statics activities are at the Statics Modeling Kit website. And thank you.
Great. Thanks so much for sharing your lessons in adaptation and the roller coaster ride and how you also made lemonade. I see a continuing theme of communication. Love to see how it enriched your methods and your data. And next up, our next presenter team will be Elliot Douglas from the University of Florida and Britt Holbrook from New Jersey Institute of Technology.
Thank you. I am going to start off with a brief overview of our actual project, and then Britt will take over and talk about some of the challenges and things we had to do. We're a bit earlier in our project than the first two presenters. We essentially have just finished our first year of our project. And so, you know, some of the activities that they've talked about are not things that we are quite doing just yet. So the inspiration, so I just point out our project, it's about incorporating social justice into engineering ethics education. It's a collaborative grant, collaborative proposal. So we have the two grant numbers. I'm at the University of Florida, and Britt is at the New Jersey Institute of Technology. I'm trained as an engineer, although I do all engineering education research now. Britt is a philosopher, and we both teach engineering ethics courses. So it makes for a good combination. Why we're doing this, here's just one example. There's a lot of examples out there, but this is this well-known paper by Aaron Seck about how students over time in their engineering programs, their beliefs in engineering as a field for engagement and social activity, and you know, the social aspects decreases over time in their engineering programs. So we're teaching them that engineering is a completely technical field and leaving out the socio-technical aspects of it. This is the graph that's often talked about. I think this one is almost even more dramatic in the fact that when the students were asked how much emphasis or how much importance do their programs place on these different things, there's this sharp break between the technical emphases and the engagement relevant emphases, not even any like overlap. So it's pretty clear that there's a lack of incorporating the socio aspects of engineering into engineering education, which is what we're trying to address, admittedly in a little limited way in our own ethics courses, but as a starting point. So what we're doing is revising our ethics classes using this understanding by design process. It's a well-known like sort of backward design approach to teaching or to course development, where you start by identifying the understandings you want the students to have, or you can think of this in terms of essential questions. You'll see that's how we did it. From there, you can apply, you develop the learning objectives. What is the evidence you want students to provide to show that they can accomplish the objective, and then you create the learning experiences based on that. And so that's the process that we've gone through. And here are the sets of essential questions. And you know, these are very broad. They're not sort of the ascent, you know, typical engineering ethics class, but we have a very strong emphasis, you know, as we drill down from these essential questions, we have a very strong emphasis on working with communities and listening, and what I would say as an engineer being humble in a sense and understanding. So sort of combating the engineer as hero myth as a means to move towards better engagement with communities and providing that social context for doing things. So where we stand on the project is we've gone through this process once. We've each taught our class once, this past semester in the middle of the pandemic, and we have not collected any data yet, because the way the project is structured, the plan has been to pilot the new material in year one in our classes, do some revisions based on some of our own reflections on how things went, and then in year two, which would be next spring, start to actually collect data. And this is a sort of just a summary of the data. We're going to use measures of perspective taking and moral efficacy at our two sites, pre-post-test design with the control groups. We each have really two control groups. We have a traditional ethics class and we have a non-ethics class. In my case, I think it's dynamics. I don't remember what it is for Britt.
Concrete engineering.
Okay. Where there's no ethics context. And doing a two-way ANOVA as well as multiple regressions. And these diagrams show the, based on the results of the ANOVA, we can, depending on what the results show, there's a variety of options for doing pairwise comparisons to this. So this is where we stand. We've finished, you know, the first round of teaching the class, ready for revisions and data collection in the spring. So now I'll turn it over to Britt to talk about some of the issues we faced.
Yeah, things going off the rails. So one of the key parts of my class that I think is really important, but part of why I wanted to do this work with Elliot was really to see whether it's important and something that's helpful to the students, is that I have as a culminating experience in the class, a field exercise where I get the students into groups of three or four, and they actually venture out into the city of Newark and try to engage a Newark resident in a discussion about some engineering related issue. And I don't know how familiar folks are with Newark, but there's a lot of bad things going on in Newark in terms we've got a EPA Superfund site. We've got a port here, an airport here, railroads here, and it all surrounds sort of these little areas of Newark. And there's a lot of sort of pollution, traffic problems, but at the same time, gentrification. And students, when I say to them, I assign them, I say, okay, figure out an environmental ethics related issue that is associated with the city of Newark. It's not hard for them to come up with examples. And so they do a little bit of research on this, and they're sort of experts in this area of what's going on in Newark. But I also have them learn about listening. And part of this is taken from a previously funded NSF project the PI was Yana Lembrinidu, and she developed some listening exercises. So I've adopted some of those from Virginia Tech and her stuff. But I also have incorporated readings, Elliot and I both have, that tend to introduce the notion of listening as a kind of counterbalance to the idea of the engineer having all the answers, going in and solving all the problems without actually listening to what's happening in the community. And so the culminating exercise of my class is this field exercise where they have to go out and actually listen. It's not even a conversation. It's not an interview. The trick of it is that they have to listen. They're not allowed any recording devices. They can't write anything down, and they have to come back and report to the class what they heard. And so, you know, this sounds great until you get into COVID. Then not only can the students not get together in the classroom, but they can't really go out and approach people on the street. I actually had this exercise last spring, not this past spring, but the spring before that, I was experimenting with it. And that was right when COVID hit and they couldn't do it. And I was scrambling. I had no idea how to try to substitute what I had been doing or had planned on doing. I didn't know. And so one of the things that we did was we consulted with our advisory group. And that was really helpful because they had some incredibly good ideas for how to handle this. In particular, they suggested, for instance, going out and making contact myself with people in the city of Newark, organizations, for instance. There's an environmental justice group in my neighborhood, making contact with them and seeing if they could sort of help set up with me, not interviews, but sessions that would be like interviews on Zoom or in my case, WebEx. So, you know, I was sort of thinking, what can I do? What can I do? And trying to plan for this. But the other thing that I did was I engaged my students in this. So when we started this semester, NGIT had moved to what they call converged learning. And that was some of my students would come to class in person and they were all socially distanced and I would be there in person. But at the same time, I was teaching the other students online via WebEx. And so the class was all meeting at the same time, but in different places. I just was very upfront with them at the beginning. And I said, look, I don't know for sure that we're going to be able to do this. We don't know what's going to happen with COVID, but let's still plan on doing the field exercise. And if we have to pivot, we will. But I engaged them in sort of helping me try to figure out how to do this and be more flexible. We also wrote about this for those of you who are in the last session. I wrote about all of these machinations and sort of disrupted plans and things that go wrong in my annual report. And I'm almost 100% sure that that's why we got asked to present in this session, because we clearly spent a lot of time thinking about how we were going to pivot if we needed to. I know I don't have a lot of time, so just very briefly finish up with one sort of result that came out of this. So the students were able to get in groups of three, go out into the city of Newark. They were able to engage people, but one of the interesting things that they reported when they came back to class was that they were all much more aware of being careful about approaching people and not being sort of overbearing and just realizing that people might not want to be approached, right? And so one group, in fact, actually went and sat down and just waited for people to come closer to them. And then, you know, they like sat down at a bench in a light rail station. And when somebody sat down at a bench next to them, they then asked, hey, would you be willing to talk to us about an issue? And so it was really interesting how this raised their awareness about being very sensitive to other people and empathetic. And it really, I think, enhanced the experience for them. And so I think it turned out for the best, especially not only because we could do the exercise, but because they took it really seriously and really thought about how to do it in a very careful way. So I will end there.
All right, great. Thanks so much, Elliot and Britt, for sharing your experience and especially how you talked about it in your annual report and engaged students and reached out to the community during this time. All good things to think about. And We are ready for our final presentation, and they're already ready ahead of me. We have Julie Lindsay at Georgia Institute of Technology and Tracy Hammond at Texas A&M University. Take it away, ladies.
Hello, I'm Julie Lindsay, and I want to acknowledge our collaborators on this project because this is actually a grant that's collaborative between five different universities. So we've got Ben Caldwell at Latrobe University. We, of course, have two amazing grad students working this among other grad students, but our two key ones right now are Josh Hurt at Georgia Institute of Technology and Matt Runyon at Texas A&M. We also have additional collaborators at Texas A&M of Christy Shyrock. We have Kim Talley at Texas State, and then we have Vimal Viswanathan at San Jose State. Again, we want to thank our very fabulous team and NSF support. So we're going to be talking about our system mechanics, which is the main focus of this grant. So mechanics is a sketch recognition system where students can literally sketch directly on the screen, and the AI software can actually recognize what the students have sketched. So we can do outlines of free body diagrams. It can recognize where you put the arrows. Here, I'm showing an open-ended creative design problem where we can ask the students to design me a truss that can hold a certain amount of weight and span a certain distance. And then the AI system can actually recognize what's been drawn, including the forces, and provide intelligent feedback. Plus, it can also do the calculations in the background of how much force this truss can hold and then give them immediate feedback. So as part of this project, the software is all developed at Texas A&M, and a big part of this project was the software development. And then I tend to be much more involved in the assessment of the different universities and coordinating that. So kind of briefly, project goals were originally to do control comparisons of mechanics to, at the time, the universities were all using paper and pencil homework, looking at the developing and looking at the teacher interface to allow teachers to, or instructors to create new problems. We want to support a full semester of homework problems so that this could be implemented across the entire semester of statics. And there was a lot of software development that was happening as a part of this project. In terms of evaluation, we were most primary evaluation was on homework exam questions. We're also looking at the stacks and force concept inventory, also doing some student interviews, focus groups, and then also instructor interviews of the software too. Well, our pivots happened long before COVID started happening, and we've dealt with more than just COVID on this particular project. With five universities, I think we've managed to hit many of the natural disasters that have happened. We've had the wildfires on California close our campuses during data collection twice. We've had faculty miss the first 2.5 weeks and also switch faculty in the middle of the semester. Dealt with COVID. We were in the middle of data collection and COVID hit. It caused major problems with our data collection. We lost most of our exam scores that semester. Massive drop-offs in student participation. And our fires a second time. And then to add to it, we had power outages in Texas this past year that then closed our campus. So those were the highly expected ones. Of course, we had the more typical ones. Data collection doesn't go as planned. Your outcome measures aren't statistically significant. You know, we expect faculty to be on family leave. You may not be able to find the grad students at the right times for the project. Occasionally students have been known to share the answers too much and then bias your data. Sometimes it's bordering on cheating, but most of the time it's usually a little more on the innocent side. And of course, you've got five different universities who are continuously making changes over the project. This was originally planned to be a five-year project. And some of these things we anticipated as we went through that this would happen. And summary, nine of these semesters of the classroom data were affected by COVID, which is a huge chunk of your data to be able to have that much of it affected. Some of the initial effects we had were dealt with, you know, fairly simply. The later ones have been much more challenging. So we've been continuing to be successful even though we've had to deal with all these different changes. I think most critical to this is really a great team of very proactive, flexible, and creative researchers. This team has worked together previously, at least parts of us on different projects. And so I think that really helped. And we're used to, as part of these projects, looking for new opportunities and better opportunities continuously in our projects. So I think that helps the entire team, you know, be more flexible, more creative. And this entire team is very good at, first of all, anticipating challenging, identifying challenges as soon as they're occurring, and then bringing solutions and then also working very collaboratively and creatively to come with new goals. Tracy's going to go ahead and talk about some more of what we did in a little more detail.
Oh, this slide, it jumps in. Okay, so some examples of problem solving that we, flexible problem solving. So we, once COVID happened, you know, the students didn't have access to the pen and touch labs that they used to have access to. Now our software works fine with mice, but not everybody can draw with a mouse, right? And so that was very problematic. And so what did we do? Well, we purchased a whole bunch of Surface Go 2s and pens and distributed them out to any student that wanted them. This worked great. Not every student needed one, but it did provide that for those who did. And the money basically came from the travel funds that we couldn't go to, the conferences that we couldn't go to because everything was either canceled or made virtual. So, and also Mechanics is really well suited for online learning. So it worked out well there. Another example is with the pre and post test. They weren't taking it seriously and having it virtual, they were taking it even less seriously because before, at least when they were doing it in front of us, it was a little bit easier. So what we did is we actually reordered the questions so that the easiest ones were first and made them harder and harder progressively. And how did we know that they were not taking it seriously? People would get like an 80 on the pretest and then a zero on the post-test, right? This is not possible. They were just, it didn't count. It was only counting for whether or not you did the test as it wasn't actually graded. And why did this work? Well, by reordering those questions, it kept them better engaged. And we also emphasized how it would be good practice for their final exam. So we gave it some value for them. Another example is data was missing. Sometimes there were class section issues. Sometimes data got a little bit of data got lost in the transition to online parental leave. So what did we do? Well, we moved sections around, found additional sections to give us more data. We integrated into a MOOC. Why did this work? Well, Mechanics was so well received that faculty were willing to use it even after they no longer have funding. Now they didn't have the ability to do the intense amount of evaluation that we did, but because we collected data in lots of ways, one of those ways was automatically through Mechanics, the teachers could just use the software and we could at least get partial data to be able to keep testing what we were testing. And so that was very helpful. Some of our anticipated and achieved successes, we've done lots of workshops and have some more coming up. It's about to be integrated into the highest rated MOOC. It's been implemented and evaluated at a wide range of schools. We've already had tons of journal and conference papers, and there's even more in submission right now, and improvements to the static concept inventory test. Additionally, thousands of students have now used this software and they've said that they love it. So this is really exciting. We now have a very sustainable version of it that can support an entire semester's worth of problems. And we're building in more and more sustainability things. And we have automatic grading of open-ended design problems, which is really cool. So, you know, we can grade problems and give detailed feedback to students on problems that have tons and tons of solutions, potentially infinite. Some key takeaways for how to succeed despite these massive challenges. Again, be flexible, be open-minded, try to anticipate the common problems that might happen, things that might pop up, and have backup plans. Focus on your goals. This has come up a bunch of times. Find creative solutions, or at least try to maximize the outcomes, even if it's not the original plan. And then three more things that I think are really crucial is when you're designing control and test experiments, make sure as much as possible to have them within the same semester, because you don't know what next semester is going to look like. If anything, COVID has taught us that don't expect next semester to be a good control for this semester's test scenario or vice versa. And so split the control and test in each semester, right? Don't divide them over different semesters. Analyze your data as quickly as possible so you can find out if there's some potential data issues that are causing problems before you find at the end that somehow you messed up data collection throughout the entire time. And collect data in lots of different ways. Get rich quantitative and qualitative data by having lots of different data sources and getting the same outcomes from different data sources. If one of those disappears, you can rely on the other one, and you can even show how the two are correlated. So you can help fill in some of those gaps. And that really has helped us as we're trying to get extra data without the extra evaluation metrics that are always possible. And just a little comment before jumping into questions, I just wanted to say that on a personal note, this pandemic has really taught me how to better teach my class because it's forced me to make some crazy changes. And for the first time ever, I have perfect on-time attendance. All of my students are completing their activities to an A level, like 100%. All the students said it was their favorite class in all 4 years. And when we've implemented these methods, other faculty are getting the exact same responses. It's just been really amazing. And they've seen it reducing cheating as well, because these same things seem to be all linked. It's about, you know, improving engagement, creating a more structured environment, which I was forced to do because everything was now virtual. But, you know, the main two takeaways that are the biggest game changer is if you can do a daily low stakes quiz at the start of your classes, that makes the summative and the formative very similar. And then that summative is less scary and you're less likely to teach and you're more likely to do really well on it. And creating that inclusive, empathetic environment. So really to having some, you know, first 5 minutes, just ask your students how they're doing, regularly querying how they're doing, do a couple one-on-ones, yeah, at least one time through the semester, do a one-on-one with each student, even if it's super, super short. You know, these are things that I can't wait to try in the next one as well. But I just, sorry for the little side note, I just felt that this is sort of a place where we're talking about things going off the rails and actually gaining from them. And so that's been impactful for me. So anyway, these are our contact slides. And feel free to reach out to us. We'd love to have more collaborators in the future too, if anybody is interested. Julie, anything else?
I'll open it up to questions, or I think we move on. We do those in other times, I believe.
Great, thanks so much, Julie and Tracy. We will have time for general Q&As at the end, and we'll be moving to breakout soon. But thank you both for highlighting the importance of inclusivity. I see some accessibility chat in the chats there, and thank you for emphasizing being proactive and demonstrating that things can go off the rails, not just for COVID, but there's lots of opportunities to adjust, and that is what we want to be reflecting on in our next session. So if I can just jump ahead here in my slides to this one. We will now transition to breakout rooms. During these breakouts, we will be discussing the question that I mentioned earlier. In the management of your project, was there a time that you found you had to make an unexpected change due to any circumstance? If so, what was the circumstance? How did you address the issue? And do you think you were successful? We hope this will be a chance to reflect and gather ideas around how you can seize opportunities to make changes that will improve the outcome of your grant work, just as Tracy left us with there, and as some are pointing out in the chat. All right, well, welcome back to the main session, everyone. We are in this portion looking forward to hear from our presenters how their discussion rooms went and some kind of key takeaways that would be great to share with the whole group. So let's see if we could maybe go through in the same order as before. Cindy, would you like to give a quick summary of what was discussed in your session?
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Well, that didn't give me much time to synthesize, but mm-hmm. some common themes. We all shared some common challenges. One of the challenges was collecting data for students to work with. With COVID, it interrupted some of that type of data collection plans. And we've discussed other ways of getting some external funds for making up for some of that. Or using some travel funds to help with that. And then talking to NSF officer about supplemental funds. And then also the teaching challenges. And we've had some situations where people sent created video clips for people and or sent materials to their home for them to do an activity, and then they discussed it in class, and those things seem to help. And I know I'm missing a bunch, but I want to give time for other people. So I'll leave it at that.
Great, thanks so much for sharing, Cindy. Mm-hmm. Eric, let's turn it over to you.
Sure, so we had, you know, diversity of experiences in our breakout room. We have a co-PI dealing with a situation where a PI wasn't awarded tenure. We have another new grant starting where there's similar concerns to some of the challenges I presented about in terms of enrollment drop from below what you were anticipating when you were designing your study. And trying to remember, we had another group that talked about similar also to what I presented about having a hands-on model type project that all of a sudden couldn't be hands-on anymore because of COVID. And they went towards virtual simulations to have students engage with the ideas from home. And then the last thing, we were starting to talk about shifting money around in budget. And I just wanted to draw folks' attention to the chat. Bond got cut off right at the end of our breakout room, starting to talk about some of the things to be mindful of beyond the broad budget management idea of you can't cross that participant support boundary in your budget without a program officer approval. So I might yield a little bit to Bon if she wanted to just reemphasize what's in her chat
post. Sure. Any budgetary changes that you make need to fit within your institution's policies or practices first and foremost. And if you are not, you know, moving from the participant support into another category, you do have a fair amount of capability to do that. But it's very important that it stay within the scope of the project that you're working on. In addition, though, you don't have to ask permission upfront if you're staying within those budget lines, not crossing budget lines. You do have to talk about it in your annual report. And so make sure that you state what changes were made, why those changes were made, and then what were the outcomes of those particular changes.
Thanks, Bon. Sorry you got cut off there right at the end of our breakout room.
Thanks so much for those insights, Eric and Bon. And next, let's hear from Elliot. What was on the mind of your breakout participants?
So we heard all about a lot of different kinds of challenges the group has faced collectively, not just COVID. And so I think the message that I would bring from it is that projects are always gonna face these kinds of challenges. I think maybe COVID just put a spotlight on it for everybody, but I think among the group, you know, everybody has faced these kinds of issues, whether it was, we heard about institutional issues related to financial problems at the institution that affected sort of everything overall, you know, natural disasters. In this case, there was an earthquake in Alaska that caused problems to getting permission from the institution to implement certain things because of, it seems like safety issues or something there's some concerns about. So being flexible, being prepared to be flexible at all times, not just because we're in the era of COVID, I think is the primary message.
Definitely. Well, that's certainly what we wanted to consider during this session. So thank you, Elliot, and to your breakout participants. And Britt, you're up next.
Okay, yeah, I kind of want to follow up on what Elliot said, that we had several people in my group who were talking about non-COVID related issues that were the sorts of things that I think people encounter normally. So I would also want, you know, one of them was not being able to get student assistance, right? So they had budgeted for student undergraduate student assistance for part of the project, and they put up the job ad on the university website and no one responded. And so the question was, well, how did we handle that? And they figured out a way. And so there I would say being adaptable is a take home message that we should all be aware of. We should all realize things aren't always going to go as we plan, and we should be adaptable. Another was instructors who had agreed to be part of the study. Now we're no longer teaching the classes that they were originally teaching. And so they really couldn't be part of the study because the new classes weren't appropriate to the study. Another one was the PI got the grant at the end of the summer and then had a whole year go by before the next summer, but all of the activities that were going to be tested were in the summer. And so the program officer contacted her and said, you need to spend your money. And she said, well, I can't spend it until the summer. And the program officer said, take a no-cost extension in the middle of your grant, which is something that she said she didn't know was possible. And I certainly didn't know was possible. And so that emphasized, I think, the importance of communication with the program officer. And then that actually led me to talk, sort of refer back to the first session earlier today. And several of the people in my breakout room had been there in that session, and all remarked sort of spontaneously, you know, this is great. This is not something that every other program does. And I will say from my own experience, I've been funded by, I think, at least three other programs, and they don't have anything like this. And so I think there was a broad consensus within my breakout group that this was a really great idea, and this is a really great program, and that this is something that I use and AAAS should keep doing and should be proud of. And I think, you know, if you guys have a way of getting reviews out or something from the opening sessions that you want to, you know, send out to other people to get them to sign up for later sessions, I suspect you'll have a willing audience. So I'll end it there.
Great. Well, thanks for those kind words and for all your thinking there. Britt, I think you're really striking a chord. I'm seeing a lot of head nodding, particularly on the staffing issue. And I want to draw everyone's attention to the chat. NSF Program Officer Ellen Carpenter has dropped in a link to NSF supplemental funding for postdoctoral researchers to mitigate COVID-19 impacts on research career progression. So that might help some of you out if you haven't seen that resource yet. And continuing with our sharing, Julie, would you like to share?
Sure. I think one of the biggest themes I saw in my group was people taking advantage and looking, recognizing what COVID actually provided. From one of the projects, able to now look at online learning, both in person and virtually, to another one of the projects had small classes that were supposed to interact. They were forced online. The students got used to interacting. So then the following semester, they were able to collaborate with students over in India, which was kind of interesting. I think some of the common strategies to deal with some of the challenges was, you know, extending the timeline. And I think one of the open questions that came up was, okay, what's going to happen to all of our grants at the end of the projects? Because I think a lot of us do not know what the total impact is going to be. And especially this summer, a lot of us are assessing and trying to, you know, data that was gathered to say, okay, what does the data look like? You know, what's the end of the project? Many of the projects were having problems with recruiting either faculty, you know, if they were supposed to be testing some of this, or recruiting students, because on top of everything else, people were just not willing to participate. And I know we saw that with our stuff too, of So as we said, you had to learn a new system, a bunch of students dropped out. And normally what happens is they see the new system, they get all excited and they love it. But they just couldn't handle anything being added to their plates.
Great, thanks so much, Julie. And Tracy, would you like to add anything to the discussion?
Yeah, sure. Sorry, I stole your screen, so we basically covered one topic, which was how do you keep up the involvement of participation of students for the surveys and all the other metrics, you know, things that you're trying to do for the studies, you know, getting engagement in your user studies. And we had multiple people echoing the same solutions, which is really restructure the way you're designing your experiments. And this also works for randomly assigned control and test groups. Basically, make all activities as a requirement in the classroom, because those things are allowed to be done to help the instructor improve the way that they're teaching, and that those will all be helpful. And then the only thing students are doing then is they're checking a box whether or not the researchers, not the teachers, but whether the researchers can actually see the data. And that makes it a lot easier. You can also provide extra credit for participating in the research. Of course, you have to give it an alternate, which usually what I'll do is say, you know, just tell me any other study that you've participated in, and I have a method to do that anonymously, so I have no idea which one they participated in. And then after the semester, although once you no longer have grades for them, it's more effective to offer a monetary incentive, but of course, make sure that you're following your IRB rules, things like that. That's what we covered. And you have the share back. Sorry about that.
Thanks so much, Tracy. I will go ahead and reshare. And it sounds like there were very productive conversations. We'd like to continue the conversation in the full group. So if you could take a moment and drop in the chat lingering questions you have that you want to pose to your peers, to any of our facilitators, to NSF, please go ahead and drop them in the chat now. Feel free to also add all of your tips from all your wisdom and trial and error and learning and experience and impacts you've had from your changes, or maybe things you wish you knew that you found out. And while people are chatting in there, I'm just gonna throw out an initial question to our NSF colleagues and whoever would like to answer. Similar to what Elliot and Britt brought up, the pandemic was unprecedented, but disruptions in grant management certainly are not. You guys as program officers deal with things going off the rails for PIs all the time, not just for COVID. So what are some other examples of kind of events or circumstances that have required projects to change and best practices from PIs you've seen doing so?
Well, this is Keith, and maybe I can offer some observations, and then other program officers, if you want to jump in as well. You know, things can happen not simply to projects, but things can happen to people. And there are inevitably projects that face need to kind of change their staff, replace PIs, co-PIs, and that sort of thing can come without any notice. It's not difficult to deal with it operationally. If you simply talk with your program officer, submit a request for a change in status for a PI, co-PI, all of that can be worked out. Communication is the key. That's really the key. Other program officers, if you have examples.
While our colleagues are thinking, and John, Bon, and Ellen, feel free to jump in if you think of something to add. There was also a question in the chat from Christine, noticing that her studies have lower rates of consent to participate during COVID. and having concerns about what this might mean for representation in her studies. Anyone wanna share tips with Christine?
I was just writing this in the chat, but I was wondering whether it would be appropriate to mention in your recruitment statement that your goal is to obtain a diverse sample, and just speak up front to encourage those from underrepresented groups to participate.
And I guess I wanted to say, to just be a little bit gentle though too, and understand that a lot of the minoritized groups are having a harder time during COVID. Mm-hmm. So they sometimes are under a lot more stress than the majority groups. So just, I don't know, maybe it's just okay that right now, maybe the important thing is to refocus and get, do more studies after COVID is a little bit relaxed.
Thanks, everyone. Feel free to keep adding to the chat for that. And I'd like to circle back to the previous question that I threw out to program officers and hear from Ellen Carpenter.
Yeah, I know in my breakout group, we talked a lot about flexibility. And I think that's true on program officers' parts too. We're certainly very willing to work with you in terms of, you know, what the project is going to turn into. How it might be different than what it started out. You know, these are grants, these are not contracts. And that's a phrase that a former program officer threw at me a long time ago. So to some extent, we do expect things to go off the rails a little bit. And this may be an extreme situation now, but I really do think that, you know, again, speaking to your program officer early and often, if you need to, just to figure out how you're gonna navigate through some of the issues that have come up, can be very helpful. As Bon said, make sure that you justify things and let us know what's going on in terms of your annual reports. And oftentimes the things you find out can be, you know, more interesting even perhaps than the original project, if you're willing to follow where things will lead you depending on the circumstances.
Great, thanks so much for sharing, Ellen. We are getting close to the end of time, but I'd like to hear from a few more people. Any last words, Tracy?
Yeah, I had one more idea about the minority recruits, which is in your ad, make it really clear what the value is for your research for the minority groups, and emphasize the importance of getting those persons in the actual data pool, right? So making it really clear what the value added is going to be really crucial.
Great.
I have one more if there's time.
Sure, absolutely.
This is following on something that Ellen said and talking about, you know, she said it's not just true that the PIs need to be flexible, but the program officers as well. And one of the things that came up in my group that I experienced, but also others did as well, is students are pretty good at this. If we give them the opportunities and what we're doing involves students, they can come up with things that we wouldn't have thought of. And often they're pretty good at it. And if we go along with it, it adds to their sense of ownership as well and agency. And I just find all of us being more flexible and including more people than we would normally include in these, at least the decision-making process, if not the decisions about how to handle things, is just, I think, a good idea.
Great, thank you. And Keith, any last words?
I don't know that I have any specific last words. I have been hearing throughout this session, and we certainly heard in the earlier session today, that these projects can thrive really, not only by the great leadership of the project teams, but by keeping that communication open between project teams, program officers, NSF, just to make sure that if you have any questions, ask them frequently. Don't worry about wondering if it's an appropriate question. We are there to be kind of backseat partners. You're the ones running the projects, but if your projects have any hiccups, come to us, because we want as much as you do for these projects to be a success.
Great, thanks, Keith. And I think we've seen today, and you guys know from experience, what a great resource the IU's community is. So everyone on this call, reach out to each other and reach out to the program officers and keep lines of communication open. So I hope everyone enjoyed today's discussion. We're excited to see your projects evolve with the lessons learned in this session. And in just a moment, I will provide instructions for accessing our upcoming networking event, but there are a few people who deserve our thanks. I would like to begin by thanking our NSF IU's program officers, especially the ones who joined us for today's sessions, particularly Ellen Carpenter, Keith Sverdrup, John Jackman, Jill Nelson for her help organizing the sessions, and also Bon Green for contributing, and all of the IU's program officers in general. We had Janelle Gosi, an NSF grant specialist in DGA, present earlier. And let's give a virtual round of applause for our IU's principal investigators who shared their experiences with us today. They also stayed on time, so we didn't have to demonstrate what happens when things go off the rails in a virtual meeting. So thanks everybody, Cindy, Eric, Elliot, Britt, Julie, and Tracy. Really nice job sharing your lessons learned, and we'd love to hear from more of you in the community about what you're doing so you can share with everybody too. And finally, I'd like to thank my AAAS IU's team for making this event possible today, including my awesome co-PI and fellow STEM program director, Iris Wagstaff, who helped select some inspiring speakers for the faculty DEI event coming up on June 22nd that all of you here really don't want to miss. And the following amazing team members with whom this series of events would not be happening: our community engagement manager, Thomas Begu, whom I hope you will reach out to share your work and suggestions for our AAAS IU's programming in the future, and our program associate, Lauren Manier, who has brilliantly, along with Thomas, coordinated logistics and whose communication prowess got us all here today. So thanks to all of you for joining us at today's events and the official start of the IU Summer Lab.